الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اليوم سندرس الدرس الرابع lesson 4. The درس الرابع, this is actually where your true learning will begin inshallah. It's the first time you are addressing this, these levels and these chapters, and that درس الرابع actually is where the challenge is slightly raised. So a number of things are being taught here. Approximately 6 new concepts are being taught over here, or 6 new things, including the new vocabulary. The first thing that's being taught here is حرف الجر. في and على, these two new words. And في and على, and later on من and إلى, these new words, they have a particular meaning. Neither are they nouns, neither are they verbs. But actually what they do is that they help us understand a relationship with the nouns, and then a relationship with the verbs. These are what are known as حروف, literally translated as letters, but actually particles. So more important to the meaning right now, because the meaning can be derived, let's look at the ruling. Everyone read with me, please. And if somebody wants to put their mic on and read with me, that's also better. So if you want to use your mic. البيت.
البيت.
في البيت.
في البيت.
نعم. So over here you have ألف واللام, and that's why you only have one ضمّة. Here you have And what's the difference of al-bayt here and this one here? You see the difference on top? What's the difference?
It's lamma. For fi, it's kasra.
Zakra khair. Over here you have a dhamma, al-bayt, and here you have a kasra, al-bayti. So what's the difference between these two situations?
Fi.
The only difference we can see is the fi. This is حرف الجر. So البيت.
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 So that dhamma comes, converts itself to a kasra because of حرف الجر. حرف means particle or letter, and جر means this thing here, kasra. جر, one of the meanings of جر is kasra. So حرف الجر means that particle which causes this kasra to appear. Is that clear?
Yeah.
المسجد.
المسجد.
في المسجد.
في المسجد.
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 في المسجد.
في المسجد.
أحسنت. شوف يا إخوة. انظروا. You have this beginning. It says كسر فتح on the ألف, then سكون on the لام, and then فتح on the ميم, and then سكون on the سين, and then كسر on the جيم, and then ضم on the دال. المسجد. Is that clear? المسجد. In the case with this second situation where there's a word before the alif and lam, you will immediately jump over the alif, and you will not need to pronounce it. You will say fill. Fill. This fi is taking you directly to the alif, which has, to the lam, which has a sukun on it. And then after that you have the meem, which is, I would say, is written, the font which has been chosen in the book is not very clear. But you have the lam, alif lam, then meem. Then you have, sorry, my handwriting is bad because of the mouse. You have seen there's a scene, trying to make it clearer, and the jim. So you have alif with the kasra on it, meem with a fatha on it, seen with a sukun, jim with a kasra. Al-masjidu. But in the case with harful jar fi, then you will go over the alif and go directly to the lam. You will not say fi al-masjidu. No, you will say fil. Is that clear, brothers? Go directly to the sukun and you will say fil masjidi. Fil masjidi. Okay, let's keep going. And the meaning of fi means when something is being surrounded by something else or entering into something else. He means inside something. Okay. This is the general meaning or the main meaning of the word fi. Al maktabu. Read please. Al maktabu. Alal. Not ala al maktabi. But you jump straight to the lam with the sukun on it, like in this case. In the case of fi and the lam. Then you read the meme. على المكتب المكتب على السكون jumping over the alif and ignoring it على then there's a meme here which comes after the lam though it's written in this way that it looks like coming before. Okay, this is alif lam Meem, kaf. Like in the masjid, alif, lam, meem. This is supposed to be seen, brothers. I'm sorry for the rising over there. Okay, so you have alif, lam, meem. Alal maktabi. And what happens? The dhamma turned into a kasra. Why did it turn into a kasra, brothers? Put your hand up. Ala is harful jar. And what does harful jar mean? Harful jar means that particle which creates this jar, this kasra. The jar means kasra. And then here we have an example of as-sariru. What type of a letter is this? What is this known as we learned last lesson? As-sariru. Barakallahu fiqh Mirza, it's Shamsi. So you don't have to say Ahsan Tadim, you don't have to say Al Sariru. You say As Sariru, go straight into the scene because of the Lam and the scene are very close to each other. This has a Dhamma on it. You have As Sariru, As Sariru, Ala, Alas. See, this one is especially going over the Alif. And over the lam, directly to the scene because it's shamsi. Al-sariri. Al-sariri. Okay, guys? So now we now the second part of the class. The first part of the class is to introduce this harf al jar. The first part of the class is to introduce harf al jar, fi and ala as two examples, and what they do to a noun is that they change the dhamma, the word that has alif and lam, to a kasra, or a word that has alif and lam, only one kasra. And I want you to imagine that that this word did not have alif or lam. How would it sound? How would this word sound without alif or lam?
Baytun.
Jayyid, barakallahu fik. Two dhammas. So if you had harf al-jar coming before it, those two dhammas would simply convert into two kasras. So if you have one dhamma, changes into one kasra. If you have two dhammas, it changes into two kasras. So baytun would become
baytin.
Fi baytin. Fi baytin. And one dhamma, al baytu, becomes
fil bayti.
Barakallahu fik. Fil bayti.